LoWeb 2013. And who are you?
I'm Selig Georgi, I'm co-founder of Kukening.
So can we see your badge?
Yeah, sure.
It says here, Kukening. Since when?
Oh, I had the idea of Kukening two years ago now, and we launched in May. So Kukening is a platform to connect people around home-cooked meals. So we're basically using dinner parties as a way to create new encounters and meet new people. It can be because you're a tourist coming to a country and you want to have a local experience and meet locals by eating local food, or you're just in your own city and you want to do something different and perhaps meet people you will have never met without us.
So you're doing the Airbnb for cooking?
Well, it can be like that, it can be seen like that a little bit. It's just that the main reason to go to Airbnb is financial. The main reason to go to Kukening is social.
But social.
The user experience is pretty much the same. We have people that are listing, that are explaining how they want to host for a meal. And people, guests, will book on our platform. Payment go through us. Trust is through the platform. So basically, the user experience, yes, it can be compared to Airbnb.
Does that mean the cooks are not making tons of dough?
No, it's just, they're not cooking because they want to get money, because if you're only hosting for two people, for example, this is not financially interesting, so it's the money you're asking for your guests will just cover your costs.
Which is good for some. If you can save 500 euro on food every month.
Well, 500, I don't know, but if you're doing it like once a week, it's enough.
So if you do once a week, how much do you get? Like three people? Can you ask? You can ask whatever you want?
It depends what you're cooking.
You can choose?
You can choose. But then the question is, will people accept coming to your place for this specific price? So for example, in Paris, it ranges from 10 euros to 50 euros for a dinner. Really different.
10 to 50 for one person dinner?
Yeah.
And people go and they pay 50?
Well, if you can have like kind of a gastronomic experience.
Fine.
Very fine. We have, you know, we have the second of a Michelin star restaurant, and he's hosting at his place.
Who? The second?
Yeah, of a Michelin star restaurant.
The second?
Yeah, the second. What we call the second in the gastronomy.
He works the whole day in the restaurant,
yeah.
And then he goes home and works more.
Yeah, and why? Because Kukening is a unique opportunity for him to connect with clients and with guests. You know, when you're in a famous restaurant, you're behind the kitchen. So you're staying somewhere and your clients won't see you. They will see the maître d'hôtel, perhaps the chef will come and say hi. But by eating with your guests, you have a very special connection. So
Kukening.com?
Kukening.com.
Is it worldwide?
We're available anywhere in the world. We have people in France a lot, in Italy, in the US, in various countries. We're in 30 countries. Okay, in some countries they only have one table, one host.
Where? Where do you have one?
In Argentina, for example, we have only one. In Hawaii, in Costa Rica, in Thailand, and I don't remember.
That's awesome. So basically you go in a city, you can see how many tables?
Yeah.
For every night? You go, I say, I want to eat tomorrow, you will see which tables might have seats.
Tomorrow might be complicated because of logistic reasons for all of us. But next week, yeah, you can see...
Why is it not possible the day after?
Because they have to plan.
Who has to plan?
Host.
The host.
Yeah.
But don't they say, hey, I have two extra portions for tomorrow?
It's not portions. You're asking them to organize a meal for you, or you're joining a planned meal. So if, for example, next Sunday there's nothing planned but it's written that it's available, we will contact the host and say, can you organize something for us? He might say yes, he might say no. If, for example, your profile is not doesn't provide enough information, so he doesn't feel confident with you as a guest.
How many people? How big is this website?
We have a few thousand members around the world ready to host you.
Few thousand hosts and even more
coming.
Guests.
Yeah.
Or what do you call them? Guests?
Yeah, but hosts are required to register on Kukening. Guests can check the website, and if they don't book, they don't become members.
Okay, but they have to register and get a profile.
To book,
that.
Yeah.
To book.
Because you need to show that
and
you're.
And the host
trustable.
Has to say yes, like Airbnb. You say yes or no.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't have to accept.
Yeah.
Somebody come and eat.
Yeah, as a host, you're free to say yes or no. That's a basic
rule. Do you in any way organize let's say, third-party places where people could go and with a bigger kitchen and with a bigger table. And
maybe in the future, but not yet.
Not yet. Does that make sense?
If it's in a special place, if it does make sense with the host, yes. If there's no link between the host and the place where you want to host something, no. Because why is it so different when you go and eat with someone at his place? It's because there's a relationship with the person you're eating with and where you're eating.
I was just thinking, maybe there's some cooks who might think it would be cool to make food for 20 people, but they don't have space.
But careful, we're not underground restaurants.
But so could you be? Or you don't want to be?
We don't want to be.
But if you don't want to be, 20 people
no, it's not, you cannot have the same connection between the host and guests if you have 20 guests. It's not possible. It's a party or it's a cocktail, it's not a meal.
Alright. You don't want to do fast food?
Oh, no.
Like peer-to-peer, come and... How about type it in and they come and bring you the thing wrapped at
it's
your
not
home?
A business.
Somebody
it's
like,
not a business. You know, I mean, as a startup, you need to define what's your business. You can have very interesting ideas, but my business is to connect people around home-cooked meals. Period. Cool. You have other startups that can do awesome things, but that's another business.
All right, so Airbnb takes 12% plus 3%. How much do you take?
Pretty much the same, 16% for the final price.
The final price, yeah. Cool. Credit card payment, PayPal payment?
Credit card payment, yeah.
Cool. Is there, do people give tips or whatever?
No, because they paid before. So they don't give tips, but what usually happens is that because you've paid beforehand, when you join a meal, you will bring something. Which is totally weird because in a sense you're a client, so you pay, but you will bring some flowers or some chocolates or something from your own country. Because it's what matters is that you're creating a connection between people. And that's what matters.
So people become friends?
Friends or just connection at least, but yeah.
And what's it called? Do you have stories of cooks that become more and more famous and more and more demand because it's so good?
We're a 6-month-old website, so it's pretty new. But we see on our platform that some hosts start to become leaders of the platform. So
become leaders of the area, the 16th arrondissement.
No, leaders on our platform that you see that some are
very
well demanded and they are the ones
who have ratings.
Yeah,
5-star
exactly.
ratings.
Yeah.
And, that's cool. How do you get from where you are to becoming as big as Airbnb? What's your plan?
It takes long. I mean, if you see the curve for Airbnb, I mean, we are a sharing economy platform and we are just not online, we're offline. Right? So we need to find good partnerships and really understand what our community is demanding. Because if we have this good community of hosts of offer, then it will be a long, long business for sure.
How many competitors do you have? In exactly what the, like the kind of like the idea where you are? Do you have lots of competitors or not very?
I think we have quite a few starting this kind of business around the world. Like in one is in Asia, one is in Israel, for example, and perhaps one in the US. In France, we have a few ones, but we're number one. So, but it's everything is just starting. So,
which one is in the US?
One in the US called Fistly.
Is it big or very small?
No, it's pretty much the same. They started a little bit before and they didn't start with the exact same concept. But and the question is not to take clients or audience from competitors. The question is, we're all evangelizing for the same thing. So who among us will be the one that cracks the market is the final question.
So there's one thread, I guess. Legal.
Nope.
No, it's not a threat?
No, because it's not an underground restaurant. You're asking people to join you at your table. So the financial contribution, the price you're asking for, is here to compensate all of your costs. And if you want a little extra, it's for your time as a person. So it's more like service than food.
So you're not, if it was underground restaurant, it would be illegal or?
If it was underground restaurant, meaning host not eating with a guest, it would be more complicated, yes.
So what could be done to allow this?
I don't know, it's not my business.
Like some politicians? Do you ever talk with those people?
We talk with politicians on a global scale with the sharing economy actors and other platforms to make sure people are allowed to do such business as what we're doing and get money.
The lady, the minister of IT or something, she's here.
Yeah.
You want to talk with her?
I know her.
You know her?
We're already in conversation.
So it would be good. I think she should sign some kind of paper and say, go crazy.
We're working on that.
Because there's a risk, but it's the risk is in people eating bad food, not in people...
Exactly.
That's a huge problem.
I was never sick when I went to a friend's place and eat with them what they've cooked. And I was sick sometimes when I went to a restaurant.
Or fast food that's bad.
Exactly.
Or something. Yeah. Cool, okay, thanks for watching.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you, Nicolas.